go. Good morning.
Good morning.
Much better. All right, today we're starting a series called The Love Project. The Love Project. By the way, I'm pretty sure that was the Charlie's Angels theme in the background. I don't know if you caught that. Neil, did you catch that? You never saw Charlie's Angels? Okay, that's good. So today we're talking about the value of love. And my hope is for these next 6 weeks, you know, a lot of people when they think of love, they only think of romantic love. But my hope is that in all of your relationships, whether it's your friendships, whether it's just loving other Christians and being a part of a church, which by the way, sometimes it's difficult. People tell me, I don't like coming to church. I don't like those people. And that's the pastor that says that. Even being more loving at work towards the people at work, this might even help some of you with your driving. Not sure if it's going to help me or not. But most importantly, I really hope, especially July 4th weekend, where some of you get to see your family or at least have time to maybe call them or check on them. You know, my hope is for those who are closest to you that you'll be able to show them love even more effectively. So let's start with this verse. Matthew 22 says this. Jesus replied. By the way, they asked him, what's the most important command? So the Pharisees were trying to trick him. They thought the most important commands were all of them. They loved the Pentateuch, the first five books. And so they made a big deal out of all those. Plus, they added their own laws just for fun. The guy who taught Paul, Gamaliel, actually is still known today as the father of oral law. So they love laws. And so, you know, when they asked him this question, they were trying to trick him into saying this is the most important. So he went back to the Old Testament and verses that were mentioned over and over, and he said love. Now, in Greek, there's at least four. Some people believe five, but there's at least four words for love. And the two we most commonly talk about are philia, where you get Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. So you know that's friendship love. And so, and that's not bad. But this word that Jesus used is agape. And so the Apostle Peter would have heard him say this about loving God. He said, agape him. And so Jesus goes to Peter, you remember after the fall, and he says, do you agape me? Which means unselfish. This word agape, Thomas Aquinas talked about it being where you are selfless. You consider the other person and all of their needs, and you defer to them. So it's this selfless, unselfish love where you just, how can I bless that other person? And Jesus goes to Peter after he denied him, and he says, Peter, do you agape me? And Peter says, I phileo you. So then, see, that makes more sense now. And then so the second time Jesus asked him, he said, do you agape me? And Peter says, yeah, I'm your friend. I phileo you. And then finally Jesus, the third time, he says, Peter, are you at least my friend? Do you phileo me? And it says Peter was hurt. I think hurt because he asked three times, but also because Jesus lowered the bar. And that's when Peter said, you know all things. You know I'm at least your friend. I mean, Peter's just at this point just like, well, whatever. And then they ate fish together. And that really is what happened. They ate fish. So early on, so here's in Jesus' ministry, they're saying, what's the most important thing? And Jesus says, love, unselfish, agape love God, the Lord your God, with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And then Jesus continues. By the way, this part of this passage is found 9 different times in Scripture. And back when the Bible was written, it wasn't like you just typed it on a keyboard and you could erase something. I mean, you had to find something to write on. You had to maybe even make something to write on. You had to find something to write with. You had to find ink. I mean, it wasn't easy. So the fact that it was written 9 times seems kind of nuts. But God didn't want us to forget this. And then it continues, this is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. Now here's the deal with this passage, okay? Basically, these words in between, this is the Pharisees would have been fine with the first part because they knew to love God, and they felt like all the rules they had, they loved their list of rules for people. But when Jesus added this second part, which also is found in Scripture, he said, if you want to love God, you have to love people. The Pharisees suddenly didn't like that because they didn't love people. They loved God. Because they thought, if I do these rules, I love God.
but they would reject people who didn't keep the rules. They would put people down who didn't keep the rules. They would walk past people who were seen as unclean. They would not talk to people who were unclean. They wouldn't sit in certain places because people were unclean. And then Jesus comes, and it says, the Bible says that they said he was a friend of tax collectors and sinners. And by the way, if you don't understand why that's separated, it's because they thought tax collectors were worse than any other sin. And we have a tax collector that goes to our church, and I always remind her every time that she's a tax collector and Jesus still loves her, but I don't. No, I don't usually add that last part. And she's not here today, so you can tell her. Now, I have some roses on my, how many, there's another ant. Okay, how many of you grow something other than mold at your house?
The shower, you're like, in the shower, you should see.
Okay, so a lot of people. Okay, so I have roses at my house. I love growing roses, and I have another rose bush to add to the collection. Right now I have five or six rose bushes, okay? Let me tell you something about roses. If I do not cultivate roses, if I just neglect them, they will die. They'll get a disease. They'll get too much water or too little water. Aphids will get to them. Too much sun, too little sun. You know, you have to keep an eye on them, and you have to give them nutrients, and you have to make sure they have the right amount of water, and you have to don't tell Tracy, but you have to poison them on occasion. We have somebody in our church that's like all natural. I'll give you some beetles. No, it's okay. I'll just spray them. But you have to maintain them. And here's the deal. You ready? Relationships are the same way. Whether it's a friendship or a love relationship or somebody in your family or even a coworker, if you're going to have a relationship with somebody, you've got to cultivate it. You've got to spend time. You've got to pay attention. You have to look for the right ingredients. You have to encourage and bless and spend time and go out of your way to cultivate it. And here's another really sad principle, and I have to explain this to people all the time. I could kill every one of my rose bushes with about this much, just a little vial of gasoline. All I would have to do is just go to each one, just put a little gasoline on the roots. Right? Kill each one. When you, in your relationship, respond in anger, you get the list out, especially, and by the way, we tend to not do this with people we don't know that well. With people we don't know that well, like, you know, with me, most of you are not going to come up to me one Sunday and suddenly cuss me out. Hopefully. Maybe after this sermon. I don't know. Right? Because, you know, you're like, well, I know the pastor, but, you know, I don't know him that well. But the people who are the closest, the people who leave their socks on the floor, the people who always do that one thing, who always say that one thing, and we start keeping the list. And then one day when we're really angry, what do? We pull the list out and we say, you always, and we read the list. We pour gasoline on our relationships, and even if we spent 10 or 20, I've known Neil now for 30 years. Last night I said, I have to be nice to him because he remembers stuff about me. And then he told me, I don't remember stuff about you back then. And I said, good, because I remember stuff about you.
Advantage Brookings.
But even though we've been friends for 30 years, just a moment of taking a list out and in anger saying, you do this, this, and this, can destroy our relationship. So even if you cultivate a relationship, be very careful that you constantly think, how do I best love them? How do I care about them? And so in the next 6 weeks, here's we're going to talk about this whole idea of love. And my encouragement to you is, no matter how great you are at loving people, that you'll be better at loving people at the end of these 6 weeks. That if you're struggling with loving certain people, that you'll be more equipped to love them by the end of these 6 weeks. So here's what we're going to talk about today. And these are the three main points came from Rick Warren's book, Purpose Driven Life. And then I kind of filled in the middle. But I think these three principles are great. Here they are. The best use of life is love. The best expression of love is time.
And the best time to love is now. So let's look at these three laws of love. Number one, the best use of life is love. And here's four reasons. A, love validates my faith. It shows that I have faith. 1 John 4:8, whoever does not love does not know God, because God is, what's the next word?
Love.
God is love. Some of you grew up being told God is hate. God is angry at you. God is mad at you. But the Bible says over and over, God is love. You didn't earn it. You didn't do enough to have it. Peter Lord used to say it this way when it came to what we do. He would say this. He would say, what you believe is what you do. The rest is just religious talk. What you believe is what you do. The rest is religious talk. And when we're held up to that standard, so many of us are like, oh, I am not a good Christian anymore. I was a good Christian until he said that. I have the right words to say, and I do the right things in public, but man, if you only knew how I thought when I drove down Grissom today. When I was trying to leave for church, and he wouldn't get in the car, or she wouldn't get in the car. I mean, I sat and honked the horn. I don't know what their problem is. If you sit out in the yard, by the way, and honk the horn, come see me later. I will go and pull the fuse out of your car for the horn, and we will take care of that today. If you are a horn-honking person out in the front yard, okay, never mind. I'm not going to go any farther. Your neighbors don't like you either. All right, so 1 John 4:20. Did I say all that out loud? Because some of that was meant to stay in. 1 John 4:20. If anyone says, I love God, yet honks in the yard, yet hates his brother, he is a liar. I don't like this verse. Can we just take it out of our Bibles? Are we allowed? No, we can't do that, can we? He's a liar. Why? For anyone who doesn't love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he's not seen. I'm going to give you just some practical applications all through this sermon. And here's the first one, the hardest one. I'm going to start with the hardest one so that it gets easier, okay? You have to forgive. You have to forgive. You have to forgive. You don't have to forget. You can remember. Joseph remembered what his brothers did. Not remembering would be dumb, by the way, for some of you. Because the truth is, you don't have to hang around somebody who has hurt you. You don't have to pursue somebody who constantly hurts you. Maybe you have an addict in your family who constantly attacks you and things happen. You can give space, but you have to forgive them. Why? Because Jesus, as he was being nailed to the cross, said, Lord, forgive them. And that same Jesus gave us the power of the Holy Spirit to forgive other people. And here's the deal. If you don't forgive, you're carrying around acid with you all the time. And you think you can just hate that person. But the truth is, every once in a while, you're spilling. I look like Kramer. Every once in a while, you just, right? And you spill it on who's ever around you. And you don't mean to, but every once in a while, you just, and you destroy other relationships. You have to forgive. Okay, I want to really emphasize this so you don't forget it. So would you tell the person next to them they have to forgive? They may need to forgive you, so go ahead. If you're at home watching, just talk to yourself. Number B. I never use letters, so I'm just going to say number B because I can say whatever I want. You can't stop me. B, love connects my life. Love connects my life. Colossians 3:14 says this, do all these things. So it's talking about things we can do, but most importantly, love each other. Love is what holds you together in perfect unity. Listen, how can we be such a diverse church and yet still have unity? It's love. Because we care for each other. What is the guiding principle of your life? What holds your life together? If success is the only thing that holds your life together, then you're only going to want to hang around people who make you successful. If money is the only thing that you care about, then you're going to. Listen, I know salespeople who move from church to church so that they can improve their sales. God bless them. Everyone. If money's your object, then you'll only look for people who can help you financially. If fame is your object, by the way, they say most high schoolers would love to be famous more than get a good job. Did you know that? Isn't that awesome to know?
And then you're like, those millennials. We were so much better in the 80s. What? What? Have you watched an 80s video lately? We weren't. We weren't any better. We just were different and weird. But that pink tux looked good at the prom, I'm telling you. Big old bow tie, large flower, white tennis shoes. White tennis shoes. Checkered tennis shoes, even better. Spicoli shoes. Spicoli shoes. If you got that joke, you were in the 80s. There we go. Maybe it's success. Maybe it's pleasure. Everything's about pleasure. Maybe it's your hobby. You may have a hobby that's your focus. Hey, maybe you're just a Netflix binger. If that's the goal of your life, guess what? You're going to get to watch every show and love no one. And when you don't love anybody, you don't get loved by anyone. So here's your second principle. And this is really the overriding principle of the whole series. So this is one you need to remember. When you look at other people, here's what I want you to think about. If you want love to be the guiding principle of your life, here's the question you need to ask over and over for everyone. What is the most loving thing to do? So that means when you're in a restaurant and you get terrible service and you want to leave nothing, you want to leave a penny just to show them what a jerk they are, my question to you is, as a former waiter, what's the most loving thing to do? When an addict comes and asks you for money, and you know if you give them money, they're going to say, I just love you. You are the best person. And if you say no to them, they're going to get mad and want to punch you in the face. And you say no. Why? Because you know by giving them money, saying no to them is actually what they need. That's the most loving thing. Will you do the most loving thing, even if it hurts you? So when you look at other people, do you say, what's the most loving thing I can do for them? Sometimes that'll be no, sometimes that'll be yes. But what's the most loving thing? That's a question that will change your life as you go through life. I want you to think of that person you don't like that much. You don't hate them because, you know, then you'd be against the Bible and you got to pretend you're more spiritual than that.
I don't hate them. I just don't like them very much.
By the way, if you grit your teeth and a vein pops out of your throat when you talk about somebody, you might have hatred. I should do a list, like a hillbilly list. If you think of somebody and think about punching them in the face, you might hate them. If you see their car and you think about keying it, you might hate them. If you're in Publix and they start coming towards you and you think of ramming their cart with yours, you might hate them. If you find out a skunk sprayed them and you are extremely happy and excited, you might hate them.
I need Ritalin.
Number C, love overlooks my sin and its cost. Above all, love each other shallowly.
No, deeply.
Oh, doggone it. Deeply. Why? Because love covers a multitude of sins. All the husbands in here are like, thank God! If you only knew! Eric, can we post this verse everywhere in my house? You don't get it all right. You do not, ready? You don't deserve love. You don't. I don't. God gave it to me anyway. I went to see Wonder Woman this week. That was a change, huh?
Anybody see Wonder Woman? Anybody see Wonder Woman? You don't have to see it. It's not a recommendation. Not that great in the middle. But in the end, I'm going to tell you, if you're going to see it, cover your ears. At the end, the lady who has killed tons of people is there, and Wonder Woman is holding a tank above her head over the woman. And the bad guy, who I see is representing Satan, says, kill her. She doesn't deserve to live.
She doesn't deserve, humans do not deserve love. And Wonder Woman throws the tank away and gives her grace. He says, they don't deserve love, but we give them love anyway. You have to realize that in heaven right now, Satan is saying to God, you know humans don't deserve love. And God says, but I give it to them freely anyway. You know, God, even when you do all kind of stuff for them, they don't appreciate it. They put your son on the cross and they kill him. Yeah, I love them anyway. That's the love that God has for us. Listen to this, Colossians 2:14. Next time that you get mad at somebody and you get your list out, You got the list, right? You know what I'm talking about? You know that person? That person. You got the list. You're ready with it. You dream about the day you run into them and they say, "So how you doing?" And you go, "Let me tell you about you." Listen to this. He canceled the debt, which listed all the rules we failed to follow. He took away that record with its rules. And what did he do? He nailed it to the cross. Now, some of you are not judgmental towards other people. I know you. You're like, "I just forgive everybody, and I love everybody," and you do. Except for the person in the mirror. And that person can never measure up. That person in the mirror fails all the time, and you say, I don't even know why God would love me. The next time you find yourself getting the list out on someone else, or the next time you find out getting the list out on yourself, I want you to imagine yourself coming before the cross that Jesus died on and saying, "God, I don't deserve your love. God, I'm broken. I'm messed up. I'm a failure. You should see. God, you know what I thought on the way to church this morning when that person cut me off? God, you know I sat in the driveway and honked and the pastor just already gave me a hard time. God, you know what I thought last night, what I did? You know everything. I don't deserve your love." And then here's what I want you to remember, and God reminds me of this verse all the time. Jesus said to his disciples, "You are no longer my servants, but you are my friends." You blow it and you mess up and you fail, and he gives you forgiveness. The next time you find you're judging somebody, or you were looking in the mirror and going, "Grr," say, "God, I want to receive your forgiveness. God, would you give me your forgiveness?" Number D. This is my favorite because I love the imagery. I try to think about my life this way. I want you to think about your life this way. Love leaves an eternal wake. You know what a wake is? Not the thing for somebody who died. That'd be kind of weird. An eternal death party? That just seems odd. No, a wake is when I'm in my kayak and I'm fishing. And as usual, I'm only catching pufferfish because I'm apparently a pufferfish professional. And if you catch pufferfish, it's like catching mater every time. And so you get the pufferfish and he comes in and you look at him and you go, "Get her done," right? And then you pull another one in. You can almost hear him going, "How you doing? Go tell your cousins to send a friend." I know. Listen, the sermon's not that great, so if you need to leave. He's like, "Can we go, Mom? I really have had enough of this guy." So I'm in fishing for puffer. Just walk him around. It'll be okay. I'm in fishing for pufferfish. Well, maybe not. I feel the same way some Sundays. It's okay. So I'm fishing for pufferfish, apparently, and all of a sudden, I'm not paying attention, and all of a sudden, my kayak just goes, and I turn around, and there's nothing right behind me. There's nothing. And I look down the Indian River just a little bit, and all of a sudden, there's a huge boat. And what happened? As the boat went through, it left a huge wake. In the same way, your life is leaving a wake. Everywhere you go, you are leaving a, for some of you, you're leaving a wake of hatred and bitterness and frustration. Some of you are leaving a wake of selfishness and self-centeredness. Some of you, as you go through life, your wake is division. Some of you, it's putting others down and building yourself up and trying to hurt other people. But others of you, you leave a wake of forgiveness. And you leave a wake of love. And you leave a wake of acceptance. Do you ever think about this? Everywhere Jesus went, he accepted people that the Pharisees rejected. The Pharisees, as an insult, called him a friend of sinners. And Jesus was like, "Yeah, that's awesome." They just got madder. He didn't accept the sin, but he accepted the person. You ready for this? The person was more important than the list. So when you're home and that person you're close to does that irritating thing that you've had on the list for a while, you know what I'm talking about, that list? Is that thing more important than the person? If you really love somebody, the list is not as important as the person. It doesn't mean you don't correct them. I have children. I correct my children. But their room being clean is not as important as my child. So I don't destroy my child in order to get their room clean.
You don't destroy a person in order to get them to do what you want them to do. The task means little. The person means the most. So if you want to really love them, then you help them along the way. For your children, you discipline them, but you give them the choice. You say, no, you don't have to clean your room. But only a clean room has a PS game system in it. A messy room doesn't have a PS game system in it. A messy room doesn't have internet access. Right? So your child then makes the choice. And you don't destroy them. You clean this room up now or I'm going to kill everybody. I'm the only one here. I
love you.
I love you too. 1 Corinthians 13:13. Three things will continue forever and leave a wake. Here they are. Faith, hope, and
love.
And the greatest of these is hope. What do you know? I'm just kidding. That's love. So faith is great. You need to have faith in Christ. Hope. You have to hope for the future because if you don't, you just lose your way. But the greatest is love. Can you love the people around you? They don't deserve it. And you don't either.
I may give away everything I have, and I may even give my body as an offering to be burned, but I gain nothing if I don't have love. You will never regret a loving action. You might regret how a person responds to it, but you won't regret doing it. I regret a lot of my non-loving actions. I go home every Sunday, and at some point I go, did I say that? Dear Lord Jesus, they need a better pastor. Could you send one, right? Now, some of you will come up to me after, Pastor, I want you to know you're the best pastor there is. I just, don't leave. Even though you're an idiot, don't leave. It's okay. We love you like you are. I was at a church one time that sang hymns and choruses. By the way, that one song we did is about a year old. We're going to do a song at the end that's about 100 years old. Jesus doesn't have a musical style. Did you know that? So I was at a church that when they would sing an old hymn, they would stand up.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
Right? And then they would sing a modern chorus.
This is the day.
And the people would sit down to show that we don't sing those modern songs.
And I was on staff, and every once in a while somebody would come to me and go, you know, I don't really like these modern songs. I like our old songs, and I go, I agree. You agree? You're young. I'm about 23, 24. They say, you agree as a young girl? Oh, yeah. Yeah, I do. I like Gregorian chants. What? I said, oh, man, those old songs.
In Monte Olivetti, Ravida Patrem.
That's what you're talking about, right? And I don't like those repetitive songs.
I know. I hate the Hallelujah chorus. This is the worst song.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
I hate those songs, right? Isn't it funny what we complain about? Why? Because we like being selfish. We like what we like, and we put what we like above people every day. So we sit down and don't care that the young people love this song. We're going to show them we hate you. We like our music. Don't you mess with our music. And there are churches dying today because they're more worried about their hymn style than they are about people. I'll never forget as a kid, we had a puppet ministry. So I can still do puppets today if I want to. Which is really weird, by the way, when you're just standing somewhere and you start going like this. Now you have that song in your head all day. So they had lights. They hooked up lights for the puppet ministry. So we would go and do a thing. We'd get up on the stage and they'd have lights. And the lights would flash. And one of the deacons, they had a deacon meeting. They called the youth pastor in. And they sat him down and they said, we don't like those lights.
What?
Yeah, looks like a bar. The pastor, youth pastor said, how do you know what the bar looks like? It was his last Sunday at the church. We missed him. It's true. He got fired. He got fired for that comment. It was awesome. They were more concerned about the lights than the ministry that was taking place. Why? Because it's about them. When you love, you look outside of yourself and you say, my preferences don't matter as much as loving that person. Pastor told me not too many years ago that Somebody was sitting here on an Easter Sunday, and somebody who was a member came down and said, "I'm sorry, you're in our seats. Can you move?" Because they cared more about their seats than they did about the person. And so everything in the church, we should care more about people. We should be willing to serve and help with the children. We should be willing to give up our place. When we love a place of ministry, we are able to give it away to somebody else. Why? Because we want to see them succeed. Why? Because we care more about the person. I love that we've got young people on the stage. You know why? Because 50 years from now, I will be dirt. Yeah, I'll be dirt. Okay, so. But there are two students on the stage. They'll still be playing. They might be playing without teeth, but they'll still be playing. You ever think about that? And if you love people, you're willing to give up what you know to help them to succeed because you care more about them. This week, I want to encourage you, do something loving. Leave a tip, leave a note, text somebody. Call that person who owes you a phone call. Hello? Don't keep score. Well, I was the last one to call them, so I'm not calling them back because I called them last time. Oh, that's so loving. Can't you see Jesus going, "I'm not dying for them because they didn't die for me last time."
I don't know why Jesus did his hand, but that was it.
Number two, the best expression, don't worry, the last part of the sermon goes quicker. The best expression of love is time. My children, we should love people not only with words and talk, but by our actions and true caring. Galatians 5:6, the only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. And then finally, live a life of love as Christ loved us and gave himself up, listen to this, as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Hey, when people get near you, they should smell the love. Jesus gave himself up as a fragrant offering. And when they get near you, they should. Now, I work out with a couple of the guys that are in this room. The fragrance they give off is not love, but the spirit they give off is love. And they come into the gym, they go, "How you doing this morning? It's good to see you working out. Don't die early." Right? But in order to love, you have to sacrifice. A few weeks ago, Ricky came to me and he said, "Dad, you want to go play pool?" And I did what every earthly father does. I looked at my phone to see what time it was. 9:00. When you're an old man, 9:00's a great excuse for not doing a thing. This is what I wanted to say. You know what time it is? It's 9:00. Deadliest Catch just came on. They're already cussing at each other. It's awesome, right? And he said, "Dad, let's go play pool." He said, "Let's go play pool." So I had this conversation with all the squirrels. We gathered around in a little huddle. I said, "How many times do you think a 16-year-old kid's going to ask you to go do something with him?" So I stayed home and watched TV. So what did I do? I got a dollar, and we went and played pool. And we had a great time. Can I tell you something? I remember playing pool with him. And you know what? 20 years from now, he'll remember going to the bowling alley and playing pool at 9:00 at night. You know, ball flying. You don't have to be a great pool player. You don't have to be great at anything with your kids, but spend time with them. In order to do that, you have to sacrifice. It means you will be tired sometimes. And you'll miss a little bit of rest, or you'll miss your favorite TV show. But let me tell you what, I wouldn't remember that TV show anyway. I'll always treasure the time with my son. But you've got to go out of your way. To call somebody, you have to say, "I'm going to call them," regardless of whether they called me or not. I've got friends who I've done the last 6 phone calls. I got the list. And guess what? I'm not going to go, "You never call me, so I'm not calling you." No, call them anyway. Do you care about them? Aren't you going to be sorry one day that you didn't call them? So call them. It takes 15 seconds to dial. And that's if you're slow. The best time to love is now. But you have to choose to love others, not just yourself. Therefore, as we have the opportunity, let's do good to all people, especially those who belong to the family of believers. Don't wait for big things. Do the little things. Use every chance, Ephesians says, you have for doing good. So when you go to a restaurant today, look for opportunities. As you're driving in the car and you want to yell at other drivers, use that opportunity instead to tell the people in the car you care about them. Now, if you're alone, yell away. But if there's people in the car with you, and when you find yourself upset, say, "You know what? I can either share hatred or I can share love. Hey, can I tell you I'm proud of you? Whenever you're able to do good to people who need help, if you have what your neighbor asked for, don't say, come back later, I'll give it to you tomorrow. Do you know what cruel, you know what the word callous means? The word callous means to have a cruel disregard for others. We live in a society that is becoming more and more callous. Someone died yesterday because they did not merge properly. And the guy shot this lady in the head because she didn't merge the right way. That's how callous we've become. Don't become callous to the people in your family. Look at your life and say, am I being selfish? In Colossians 2, talking about the church, it says, the purpose is they may be encouraged in heart, united in love. Why? So they may have the full riches of complete understanding in order they may know the mystery of God, namely Christ. My goal in the next 6 weeks is to be more loving. I hope that's your goal. I hope that when I see people, I think, what's the most loving thing I can do for that person? The best use of life is love. The best expression of love is time. And the best time to love is now. Let's live it out. If you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, maybe you know about him, you thought you were earning your salvation, you thought maybe by coming to church you got extra credit. But I want you to know Jesus died for you and your sins because you and I are broken and messed up. When I was in high school, I came to the point of going, God, I've done a bunch of good things, but I've never surrendered my life to you. And I said, Jesus, I want to surrender my life to you. What do you want me to do? And I came before the cross, and I said, here's my sin, here's my shame. You take it. When you become a Christian, that's what happens. He exchanges your sin and your shame for his life and eternal life. Maybe you're here today and you're a Christian. The truth is, you're not very loving. The Holy Spirit, the Bible says, when you become a Christian, will give you the power to love people. So begin to say, God, would you help me to be loving? If you need prayer, I'll be here after the service. We're going to have a time of giving in just a minute. When you give, it's one way to love. Because it's a way of saying, hey, I have a lot, and I'm going to give what I have away. Or I have a little, and like the widow in the Bible, I'm going to give what I have away to help other people, to show them his love. Let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Father, thank you for this morning. Lord, I do pray at the end of this series that we would, as a church, be more loving towards each other. Father, we would also, in the middle of that, find that when we love other people, we love you more. So, Lord, help us to be a church that loves and gives and expresses that love to the community so that when people come here, they would say, what a loving church. Help us to not be selfish in our love. Father, help us to go out of our way to see other people, to value them, and, Lord, to look to do the most loving thing for them. We thank you for your love for us, that in the middle of time, you stopped all that you were doing and you came and gave all that you have for us. Lord, thank you for this time today. Bless each one here in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Have a great song to close the service. It's an old one. It's not a Gregorian chant, though, but it's an old song. So we're going to do an old song today. You give what God's put on your heart, and I'll be here after the service. Thanks for coming this morning.
Yeah.
chant, but I do like that song, so it's good.